My name is Rochelle Kincaid, and I want to share with you my story about how Jesus has rescued me from the torment of anxiety. I was brought up in a home that loved Jesus. Jesus was a part of our everyday life, and I was raised by two amazing parents. I have a younger brother as well. I grew up in Canada, so I was born and raised there. And I remember different times in my life as a child and early teen when I would have moments where I would get this overwhelming sense of dread. I would get this overwhelming sense that something just wasn't right. But I never knew what it was. I never knew if it was something someone else was going through or if something was gonna happen. And I never got resolve, but it was just this instantaneous, this fear of dread. And so I just kind of went throughout my life having moments like that. I continued on in my life as a young adult. I loved to travel. Traveling was like my way of freedom. I loved to go on missions trip. I lived overseas for a year, taught in a school in the jungle with my best friend, and it was probably one of the most amazing memories, I would have to say, in my life, was being completely immersed in another culture, just living my life and not having any restraints, no fear. I mean, there were big spiders where I lived. There were scorpions, there were people with machetes, there were poisonous snakes, and I was just, I don't know if I was oblivious to it, but I was just free. And I remember that as, one of those amazing times of my life. And so that's how I lived, was completely free. When I got married to my husband Travis, we moved here to Seattle, and we were here for only a couple months, and then we ended up moving to Nashville, Tennessee. And that was a really hard move for me, specifically because I was super close with my family and I loved being near them, and moving from 6 hours from Canada to here, it was an okay thing that I could, deal with. But then when we moved across the country, I really started experiencing signs of stress. My body would respond with my heart beating in weird ways. I would get sweaty, I would not be able to sleep at night, and that was kind of an inclination, okay, there's something going on. So I just treated the physical aspect of it. I never really looked into the emotional side of it. I just kind of went on. And I would have to say the real true beginning of my anxiety was when I was pregnant with my first child. I was about 6 months pregnant. My pregnancies were very difficult because I had physical issues that required high-risk doctors, required me giving myself injections every day. And so it was a stressful season. Plus, I didn't have my family around. And it was just a very stressful time. I remember it was a Sunday and I had bent down to pick something up and my heart just, it felt like it just exploded. And then it just started racing. And it was so out of control. I didn't even know what to do. So my husband drove me to the ER and the doctors were great. They got my heart back to a normal rhythm. But that event ushered in a season of utter torment in my life. I was working at our church at the time, and I had to quit my job because my fear was that if I were to be out driving my car or going to the grocery store or being out without my husband or somebody, that heart issue would happen again and I would be alone and I wouldn't know what to do. And I would die. That was my fear of dying. And then my child dying. And so I thought, if I can control my world, if I can stay home and just live here in this safe little bubble, then I'm gonna be fine. And so my pregnancy continued. I was on bed rest. I had her prematurely. And then after my baby was born, I did not leave my house for over a year. I thought that this is how I can control my anxiety, by limiting where I go. And it was brutal. It was so isolating and so lonely and dark and scary. And so a year after, I was given the opportunity to have a heart procedure. And so the doctors went in and they did a procedure where they deal with the nerve endings so that my heart wouldn't go into that arrhythmia anymore. And so after that procedure, I was like, oh, I'm free. I'm healed, right? So I believed that. I lived my life like that. I kind of picked up from where I had left off before, and I lived my life. We had two more kids. We ended up moving back to Seattle from Nashville and came home to live near family, and we're just living my life. I remember my kids being really little, and I would pack them up in the van in the summer, and I would drive 6 hours by myself to go be with my family. And it reminded me of how I had lived like long before, right? Just those freedom days of jumping in the car and just driving. And I did awesome. Like I was free. So fast forward, 2014, it was the last day of school for my kids. It was June, and my heart freaked out again after eight years of being completely fine. And I was stunned. I was shocked that it came back. I didn't think it would come back, and it showed up. So unannounced and so something I never wanted to see again. And so I went to the ER. That was a really hard day because Travis was driving me to the ER while my oldest daughter was waiting to catch the bus. And she knew that I was going to the ER. And she was terrified. And I was terrified too as I drove past her waiting for the bus, and I was like, I pray that I see her again. And so we got to the ER, and God was so faithful to bring my heart back into rhythm before they had to paddle my heart with the paddles, you know, and God was so good in giving me that opportunity not to have to have that happen, but it definitely created trauma in my life. The trauma returned from those 8 years ago, and I was back into a deeper hole than I had been before. My body responded in a very different way. I was having trouble eating. I wasn't processing my food at all. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't function. I couldn't take care of my kids. I was in complete despair, and I was distraught, and I thought, if this is how I'm supposed to live the rest of my life, I don't want to live. It was the darkest, most tormenting season of my life. I was lonely, and I was angry. I was angry that it had come back. I was angry that it was stealing my life, that it was stealing my time with my husband and my children. I was missing time with my kids because I couldn't handle myself. I couldn't get away from myself. I couldn't get away from the fear. I couldn't get away from the shaking, the headaches, the nausea, the insomnia, the just terror. And my husband, my heart breaks for my husband and people like him that have family members that struggle like this, because I know for him, he felt helpless. He didn't know how to help me. He wanted to help me. That was the last thing I wanted. I just wanted him to listen. And so he learned how to listen to me, but it's heartbreaking because he felt like his hands were tied, and he was watching his wife suffer and be destroyed. I knew that something needed to change, and I didn't know what. I was mad at God. I knew something needed to change, but I didn't really care either. Like, it was this weird space to be in. And I remember after many nights of not sleeping because of my body, and I began to really hate my body for the way that it was reacting and responding. And I remember this one night I was lying in bed and I was like, Jesus, you either need to take me home or you need to heal me, because I can't do this anymore. And I remember lying there and I saw this white sheet coming up from the bottom of my feet all the way up over my head. And he just said, this is my shalom covering you. And I slept that night for the first time in like a week and a half. God met me in my despair. It's like, he said, I'm here. I've always been here. And that was my first sign of hope, that I hadn't been left alone, like I had started to believe, right? I was like, okay, well, maybe he is with me. And so I started praying for help. I started praying for support. And through 6 months of digging in and researching, I found an amazing naturopathic doctor who has walked alongside of me and told me that I'm not crazy, told me that there is hope and there's things that we can do. Within that same season, I found an amazing counselor, a Christian counselor who has directed me to God over and over and over again, and has just enlightened my heart and my memory to who I truly am. And that's the process. That is the process in anxiety and in these moments of fear and in these moments of terror. As much as we feel it is so overwhelming, and it's like you are trying to like figure out and see a way through it, and it seems so confusing and so huge and so big, and yet God is like, it is simple. The simple truth that love casts out all fear. His perfect love is what casts out fear. And so I started just, number one, forgiving him, though he did not need to be forgiven, but God and I reconciled. And then I started to see myself in a different way. Instead of hating my body for me not being able to trust it, because I could never trust it. I never knew what it was gonna do on any given moment. Right? So I was like, okay, but you know what? If God loves me perfectly, then I need to care for myself too. And God has shown me such kindness in this season and so much gentleness in this season. I need to treat myself like that as well, just like how he treats me. And so it was this beautiful exchange of God being kind and gentle and loving. And in turn, I was giving that to myself too, and not beating myself up, because man, that is so detrimental when we're trying to heal, when we're trying to grow, we're trying to transform with God's help. Is, you know, he's working on this part, but yet we're in complete turmoil with ourselves. And so I began to care for myself. I began to listen to what my body was telling me. I began to be aware of different tendencies, of the lies that I was believing, the lies that the enemy kept telling me, that became that cycle that went over and over and over again. And God was showing me the truth behind those lies and was completely obliterating the lie that I was believing about my identity, about whose I was, and who I belonged to. And that is where the victory came from, was truth and the transformation of my mind. Scripture tells us that we will be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And that is a discipline. That is a process that I have learned over this season of healing, was to transform my mind, to take every thought captive. Because if I don't, then it'll go back to those cycles of lies and those cycles of complete destruction of self. And so it's a place where you come that you realize, number one, I can't control my circumstances. I can't control the world around me. I have to give that to God. And I have to be utterly dependent on God for every step. You know, I felt like I was like a baby taking little tiny steps. And it was okay. As much as I wanted to race to the finish line and be like, oh, I'm done, I'm healed, it's over, God's like, I'm gonna give you this for today. This is gonna be your brave moment today. Your brave moment is going to the grocery store by yourself. Okay, you did that, that's awesome. Now, next time we're gonna go to Costco by yourself on the weekend and see how you do. And it was just baby step after baby step, but in my mind, it was victory after victory after victory. The battle seems so huge, and it is, but my focus had to be on the victor, which is Jesus, not on the battle. You know, he came into the middle of my war, and he has sat with me in the middle of my mess. And I am just so blown away at his kindness and his gentleness and his patience with me. And my journey isn't over. I know that I still have moments when I'm afraid. I still have moments where I get nervous. But what's the beautiful part is that now I know what to do. I know where to go. I know the dialogue I need to have in my head. I have the tools with me that if something were to happen, I know exactly what to do. And that is freedom. Yeah, this might be my thorn in the flesh like Paul had. You know, we don't know what Paul's was, but this very well might be mine. But it's a gift. It's become precious to me, because it keeps me dependent on Jesus, because it keeps me close to him every minute of the day sometimes, and sometimes I have a season where I've been good for a while. It doesn't matter though, because I've learned to not be reliant on myself to control my world. I've learned to be dependent on him to guide me, to lead me, to be my victor like he's promised to be. And so I look forward to the freedom and what that's gonna look like in my life. You know, I started traveling again. I go on airplanes by myself, which is still nerve-wracking, but I do it scared. I do a lot of things scared in my life, and that's okay. I'm okay to be scared. But what I'm not okay with is not living. I'm not okay with not living out the purposes and the callings that God has put in me. I'm not okay missing out anymore. And so it's a daily battle. It's a daily walk, it's a daily fight some days, but I'm okay with that. And God is good, and there is hope, and you don't have to do this by yourself. Despair is not gonna be your final destination. Neither is misery, neither is shame. If God can heal me, he is so so much for you. He has so much healing for you, for your family. It's a whole experience. You know, it's body, mind, soul, and spirit. It's not just, I'll just get the physical figured out, or I'll just get the emotional. It's the whole person. God has the right people already lined up to support you, to walk with you, to come alongside you and cheer you on, to hold your hand when you're afraid to go into those scary places. He's already laid out your healing. But he needs you to do one thing. He needs you to make the choice to say, yes, God, let's do it. Let's go after this together. It all comes down to choice. Choosing, am I going to stay in this place of despair and shackles and complete darkness, or am I going to choose to fight for my healing that God has already provided for you? He's already provided that for us. So, you are loved. You are not alone. You don't have to go through this by yourself. And there are people here waiting to walk alongside you. So don't give up. Don't succumb to it. Live free.